Thank you. Woo. Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, here in Britain, we ought to be truly proud. Proud that as long as Britain can keep inventing things like that, we'll never get into trouble. Now, I know you're thinking, what is it? It's a vase, a vase, or a vase. But a vase, a vase, or a vase of such revolutionary design, the rest of the world will flock to Britain to buy it. It has a hole in the top where you pour the water in. Doesn't every vase? Yes. But this one has a hole in the bottom where you can pour it out again. You see, as long as we can keep coming up with stuff like this, we'll never be in trouble. Not only that, although this vase, vase, or vase will take a small bunch of flowers or fleurs, this splits into two. Two vases for the price of one, or admittedly, the flowers have to be littler. But that's the way it is. Not only that, it can be used as binoculars. Or if you want things further away, binoculars the other way around. And there's no glass to get in the way when you're looking through them. You have to think about some of these. Also, egg cups. Providing you know a hen. Never mind. Who can lay them two at a time, I was going to say. Now, this is worthy of examination by a member of our audience, and tonight we've chosen a young lady, I think, out the audience. Yes, would you mind coming up here, madam? Now, this young lady comes onto the stage. What's your name?
Pamela.
Pamela, sit down there, Pamela.
Thank you.
What do you think? Thank you, Debbie. What do you think? A vase, vase, or vase, yes?
Yes.
Is there anything strange, funny, untoward about it, other than the fact that it splits into two pieces?
And that it's got holes at the bottom.
Pardon?
And that it's got holes at the bottom.
It's got a hole at the bottom, yes. For the water to come out of.
Yes. That's perfect.
That's perfect. Yes. You see? See? Now you're getting as silly as the rest of us. What I want you to do is not only examine, I'll put this back together, you examine the rope. Now the rope is important as well, I mean as well as you'll know, because you see this. If that is there, and this goes all the way through, and you've just examined it, allow me to show this to a camera, because it's worthy of a quick look at the camera. And if we look through there, the camera should be able to see me all the way through it, and I should be able to see the camera. Therefore, there is nothing to impede the entrance of the rope, like so, and it should come out the other end. And it does. Now... Not only do we have a vase, vase, or vase, which is split into two, take eggs, used as binoculars. have a hole in one end and that. We also have a form of primitive yo-yo for children to play with whilst you're out buying the flowers to fit into the vase, vase, or vase. Say yes, Paul.
Yes, Paul.
The thing I find amazing is that sometimes it does not go up or down the rope. It just stays there, suspended in the air, like that. Now, some people think, therefore, that there is something inside the vase, vase, or vase, but you have just examined it, and I shall do this all at fingertips. Look, I shall remove that quite simply, like that, and you can look at that, and this, which should split into two, hopefully, there it is, it does. Can you now look in there? Is there anything in there at all?
No, nothing.
Not only that, we have on very special offer... Another one. They're breeding. Now, look. I want you to take one of these breeding vases. And I'm going to put that on there and put it... You bent this one. Right. We just put it back together, like that. There are two vases. Pick them up. Look through them. Anything strange about them?
No.
No? Put them close to your eyes and have a look in. See? See, wide-angle binoculars, the way you held them as well. You're inventing. Pick a vase, madam. Any vase. This one or this one. Okay. Now, we've also got two pieces of rope. Pick a piece of rope. That one.
Yes.
Right. You know what to do. Take your vase, lay it on its side, on the table, insert the rope into the orifice, and let it go all the way out the other end. Now, look. Do yourself a favour, and it is a little favour. Get hold of your rope and pull it out, like that. All right? Fantastic. Get hold of the vase and knot the rope and just tip it up like that. Good. Ah, your rope has fallen out. Put it back through. Now get hold of the rope, like that, a little higher. Leave go of the bars, like that. Oh, that's strange. This one is working fine. Perhaps you should, let's have a look at this. Examine the rope again, all right? Would you like to examine the bars again? And I will look at, nothing in yours? No, hold it up and point it at camera 5 so they can see it. Good girl. Right through. Is there anything funny about it?
No, nothing.
There's nothing funny about yours either. Look, the rope goes all the way through and out the bottom, like that, okay? So there's nothing funny about yours, except for the one statement I made in the very beginning. What was that statement? It had a hole at the bottom to pour things out of. And for joining in this show, I should like to pour you a drink. And if you see, it pours out of the bottom. So I wasn't lying. And it does, in fact, also pour out of the top. And there is a most mysterious vase, and there's a drink for you while we get ready for the next item.
Thank you.
Just sit and enjoy that. Ladies and gentlemen, earlier this year we went to a most mysterious place, and I took along with me a very special guest to act as an independent witness to what was about to happen. Well, look where I am this week. I'm up here, the new... Was that good?
That's enough.
That's enough. Fulton MacKay, of course, with me outside the monster exhibition, Loch Ness, Scotland. Do you believe in that?
In the monster?
Oh, aye.
Well, I wouldn't call it a monster, but I believe in it. I believe there's something in that loch.
Do you?
Yeah, I do. And I don't just mean fish. I mean, I believe there is this creature in there.
Believe in wishing wells, you.
Oh.
There you go. Oops, that's
that
upset. That's upset your national instinct. Here, hang on. Get it back again. Let's go and see the exhibition
Come
and
on,
meet
then.
The fellas. Now, look, you see, this is a big model of Loch Ness, which is enormous, isn't it? It's vastly. And these two strange creatures over here, well, this one over there, that's Ronnie. You see, he owns the place, Ronnie Bremner, and Tony Harmsworth, who looks after it. He's the curator of the exhibition and museum. Now, Fulton, will you look at the size of the loch? It's enormous, isn't it?
Yes.
It is.
What is it, about 23 miles, isn't it? Something like that?
Coming up to 24.
24 miles.
It's coming up to, it must be getting
and
bigger.
And it's very deep, isn't it?
Well, it's 750 feet deep. It's
deeper
also,
than the North Sea, though.
Yes, yeah. In fact, almost twice the depth
amazing.
Of the North Sea.
Yeah.
And you could put the entire human race in Loch Ness three times over and lose them.
Well, all of them?
Everybody.
Good. So there is room for a monster?
There's room for a few mysteries.
A few mysteries, yes. Because
yeah.
There'd have to be more than one monster, wouldn't there, really?
Oh, you'd have to have a colony. I think zoologists have said 20 or more.
Well, we're surrounded by evidence, aren't we?
Have either of you seen anything?
Yes, I did. I saw something last year for the first time ever.
How long have you been here?
I've been here 20 years.
And you've never seen anything at all,
nothing
well,
at all.
Last May?
That's right, last May was the first
time.
No, I hadn't been tippling. No.
This is upright in Scotland.
Yes.
What did you see?
I saw a large black hump about 100 yards from the shore, moving from my left to the right at 10 o'clock in the morning. Very bright, nice day, calm.
Well, in that case, you see, I think I can solve all the problems. See, I'm going to go fishing for it. Now, I know that sounds wacky, but I've got this little device.
Yeah.
Where's your
seeing
fish?
Is believing.
Well, Paul, in the biological section of the exhibition.
The biological section.
Yes.
We're going.
Are you going to do this, really?
I am going to show you. Come on, have a
look.
Okay, let's go and find out.
Is it real?
Well, now, at the other end of your exhibition, you've got these fish. These are not indigenous to the loch, though, are they? These are rainbow trout.
That's correct.
Doesn't matter. But they're not my fish, they are yours.
Oh, yes, they're our fish.
We've got viewers, you see, who don't believe me sometimes.
We're waiting for some alpine char, so the rainbow trout are there until they arrive.
These will do fine, son. All fish are attracted to this. Doesn't look like much, does it? But it's a device for attracting fish, and if you want to sort of make one up yourselves at home, you'll be able to try it out. It's Looks like three curtain rings. You don't look like you've been
suspiciously eating. Like three curtain rings.
Yeah, no. I'll confess, they are. But three goldy-coloured rings is what you need, and you just dangle them in the water like this. I'll try and get my hand through here without ruining the suit. And you lower them into the water, and the fish will be attracted to them. So there you have it. Quite amazing. So fishermen up and down the nation will now be, you know, dangling these from their hooks, you see. Worms are definitely out now. And you wouldn't believe it. Look, what we're going to do is we're going to have a big one of these out on the lock in a little while. And, Ronnie, we're going to use one of your boats, as they say, where I come from.
Right.
I'm going to put cameras on, and why don't you pop back a little later in the programme series? In the meantime, I'll return you to the studio. Well, in fact, here we are back in the studio and I'm playing with my toys. These are from the Cabaret Mechanical Theatre down in Covent Garden, and I think they're fun. Look, you see, if you turn the handle here, I've worked with this singer. Look at the way she... And for all those people who, of course, watched Opportunity Knocks years and years ago, see if you remember this. Go on. To myself, this is the lion that can't spell. I hope I turn his tail the right way, or he might do more than just not spell. There you go. You start to turn the handle, and he can't spell. And you can see that, especially when he roars. Look how he spells roar. Isn't that wonderful? I think this one's my favourite. This is also supposed to be a lion, and this is the world-famous lion tamer with his back to you at the moment. I'll turn him round. There he is. And just watch. Not only is he brave, he's brave enough to put his head in the lion's mouth, and it misses him. And that's really cool. I don't know. Oh, hang on. Yes. Yes, it closed while I wasn't looking. This is, of course, particularly appealing to me, being a magician. It's the world-famous magic carpet, all right, that we're all looking for to save our airfares. And isn't that gorgeous? I think that's a beautiful design toy. But what surprised me was how big some of the dolls were, the toys and that. And some have different motors, of course. They have clockwork motors. Now, what you're about to see is not electronic. It uses no batteries or anything like that like we used to. It's quite old, in fact. You can see this from this oversized key. And if I can just get it like this and really get it wound up nice and good like that, and then if I can find the on switch, it's there. And then, all by themselves, they dance. Of cards, where each week we do a little card trick, and I'm joined by two beautiful ladies tonight. Oh, what's your name?
Eleanor.
Oh, that's posh, isn't it? Eleanor. Where are you from?
Watford,
yeah. Nearly right. Now, where are you from?
Watford.
Oh, your friends?
Yes.
You see, the BBC never tell me who I'm getting out of the audience. It's always a secret. What's your name?
Jan.
Oh, that's better. I can spell that. Now, this is a piece of yellow paper, and around it is a board, and around the board is some cards, not a complete deck. And you're going to pick a card, four cards, in fact, in a most unusual way. First, sign your name just across that end of the piece of paper, if you wouldn't mind. All right? Oh, thank you. Signed right across my finger there. Look, already. Eleanor is printing. That fooled us. And you sign across that end of the piece of paper. Yeah, that's it. Oh, yes. Real joined-up writing for Jan. Yes. We'll just get rid of that. And what shall we do with this now? As you can see, it is blank both sides. We roll it up into a little roll like that. Now, it would unroll. So, being of a clever disposition, I'm going to pop it into this jam jar. Right? Miniature jam jar, empty of course, and you put that in there, and then it cannot unroll, all right? Similarly, no one can get at it, especially if we seal it with this, which is a little lid which goes on there, and according to the book, goes clunk and click every trip. Now, what you're going to do is choose playing cards like this. First of all, make the sign of the devil. Yeah, very good. Join our hands together, communicate with whoever's upstairs. Now, what you do is you just get rid of one hand each. Not bothered which. Good. Put your fingers on the top like that, joined. That's it. Interwoven, as it were. It's quite all right, because you're friends. Now, what you do is you just let that go round and round like that, rather like a Ouija board, all right? The only thing I would ask is, so that our cameras will know where you're going, is I would ask you to push the cards out from the side that I choose first, you see? So you go round and round and round, and I'll put those cards, when I tell you, into this. Now, this is a little plastic stand. I'll put it there so you can see I'm not cheating. Push one of those cards out first on the audience side. Anyone on your light, see? Both pushing against it. It's okay, I'll get it for you, love. All right. Oh, go on. That was a mistake. I should let you get it. There you are. Look, I'll just put it in there, all right? You're supposed to be pushing, not grabbing. Right, now. Round and round. Now where should we go? Jan's side. Let's push a card out of Jan's side. Yes. Now, I don't know. Don't move. Don't move at all. I'll get it out. All fingertips, you see. You've got to let the people at home see we're not cheating. Goes into the stand, see? Now, you go round and round. Now, I don't know whether you feel a force guiding you to a particular card or whether one of you's got bigger muscles than the other. But what you do is, I'd now like you to push one out this side. I'll move this back just in case you go for middle. You might go at the end. Anywhere you like, just let the spirits move you. It's all happening here down at the old Ouija board. Okay. Thank you very much. We'll just take that out. Now, of course, go round and round again. Fingertip stuff this. I put it into the stand, if I'm allowed to. Yep, good. And away you go. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. How many's on the side? 3, 6, 7. So, that's the one. Did I say push this out? No. But you've had a free choice, yes? Okay, now for the first time, you may lift your fingers off the jam jar. And you, Jan, are now custodian of those cards. You might be wondering why. No, just hold them about there, sweetheart, and you keep that up there so people can see in our audience here that there's no way I can get at either of those. You might be thinking that, hello, he didn't show us the cards. The reason was simple. I wanted you to wait till the very end to see that all the cards are, in truth, all different. And if I can just take that off there like that, oh, That's it. You can now see all the way round, all the cards are all different, and I'll just plonk that there. And now let's see what you picked. You picked the King of Clubs, the Ten of Hearts, the Six of Spades, and the Three of Clubs. This was the order that you picked them in. You went round like that. Let's have a look at the jam jar. Now, this jam jar's been here all the time. You've had your hands on it. You've been hold of it ever since. If I just click the top off like this, OK, and put it to one side, you can see inside here this. Now, this has got on it... There's nothing else in the jam jar. That's just empty. This has now got on it your name, Eleanor, and your name, Jan. But writing is on it now, and it says on there the Six of Spades, the King of Clubs, the Ten of Hearts, and the Three of Clubs. You're chosen by five. My next guest comes from the United States of America, where we get many young people coming over and showing us new ways to do things. Remember air jazz and juggling and things like that? This young man's found a completely new way to present his kind of magic. It's a pleasure to have him with us. Please welcome Jeff McBride. Marvellous act. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I...